Welcome to He Did This to Me, the sports talk show from a father and son who happen to be mostly optimistic Jets, Knicks, and Mets fans. My name is Nick, a.k.a. Goody, and with me is my old man, a.k.a. the big guy, Noel. And just like his name, all we do is win. Let's get to the show. It's time to begin. After being down 17-0 in the first quarter, the Jets battled back, but ultimately lost 23-20 to the Kansas City Swifties. Talk to me, big guy. What did you see, and how are you feeling after Sunday night?
I'm not more of a Taylor Swift fan, that's for sure. No, it was a good game. It was a good game, and we played pretty well second half. Listen, we're down 17 points. That's not good. You know, anytime you start in a hole like that, it's hard to dig out. But I thought we fought valiantly. I was very, very happy with the way the team showed toughness and fortitude. That, to me, said a lot about the togetherness of the team, the way they feel about one another, and the way they feel about their coach. So I was happy with all of that, you know, besides other things.
Yeah, I mean, definitely some good things to take out of the game. You know, they say that there's no moral victories. I mean, I would argue this is as close as it gets, being able to lose by only 3 points to the defending champs. But if we go ahead and we dive into the game, the first thing that I want to dive into is the officiating. The officiating was deplorable. It was disgusting. It was downright embarrassing for the entire NFL. And as I said last week, everybody was going to be watching. Well, everybody was watching, and everybody got to see not only that call against Sauce Gardner, which there's just so many different levels where, you know, you go back and you look at that call and it just seems to make absolutely no sense. You feel like the Jets definitely got hosed there. I mean, first and foremost, there's the fact that the receiver, Valdez-Scantling, he initiated the initial contact. He comes in, he makes contact. Then those two, they kind of hand fight. Nobody really gets grabbed. There's no jersey tug, anything like that. You just have this referee who's over at the side, waits until he sees the entire play develop, and then decides to throw the flag. That was the other thing. You know, Sauce made the reference to basketball in his post-game comments, talking about the fact that, you know, it's like a guy, you know, missing a shot and then going ahead and calling a foul. I'd like to, you know, take it even another level when you compare it to hoops, where you don't bail guys out when they're putting up bullshit shots. And so when a guy is taking a shot and it's not a strong attempt that was going to go in anyway, and he kind of gets bumped, a lot of times you'll see refs in the NBA swallow their whistle. And you see the same thing in football sometimes. That ball was thrown into triple coverage, and it was definitely not going to be a completion and was probably going to be a pick no matter what happened, you know, right, as far as Sauce grabbing the guy early. So the fact that he went ahead and called that, I just, you know, it's really heartbreaking for the game to end on something like that. I've also heard reports that Jermaine Johnson, that, you know, he's actually still getting held as he tried to get into his car that night. I don't understand how that goes by and we don't see a flag. I mean, the replay, you have the line judge that's probably looking directly at it. You have the two guys that are in the backfield that it's happening right in front of them, and no one makes the call. I mean, and not to mention that call on JJ in the first quarter was questionable as well, where the other guy basically throws a punch at him and he's the one who acts second, so he gets caught. But just overall, I thought the officiating marred, you know, what could have been a really good ending to a really good game on Sunday Night Football.
I agree. I mean, they were terrible calls. Both of those calls were absolutely terrible, or the non-call, actually. But, you know, I mean, what are you going to do? I'm not one, as you know, to blame the loss on the refs, and I never do that, and I won't today, but I will say that those calls were momentous in the fact that they happened at that time and everything. You know, a lot of people with their conspiracy theories are talking about fix this and fix that. It's not that. That's garbage. But I do, okay, the horse collar call against KC early in the game, I didn't think that was a horse collar at all. Okay, but we got that call. Hey, I'll take it. But that was ridiculous. I don't even know how they make that call from the front. And he grabbed his jersey. He didn't even have his hand inside his pads. That was a terrible call, but obviously we'll take it. But you know what? It came back to bite us in the end. And yeah, you hate to see that because, you know, you'd like to think the refs have enough wherewithal with this situation to know that now is not the time to be making that sort of call. But, you know, and listen, there's so many times that people make calls And then they come to the mic and say, there is no foul on the play. So they could have done that, and they didn't, you know. And this guy could have gotten that interception. You know, it's not like they stopped play, you know. So they could have come back, huddled together the refs afterwards and say, there is no foul on the play. You know, especially if they, in their huddle, talk about, hey, how did you miss that holding on this guy, you know, number 11 getting held? But clearly that didn't happen. So what are you going to do? We lost a tough game. We have to play better. You know, a couple things we clearly need to do better if we want to win that game.
I mean, listen, I'm you know, blaming the game on the refs is not, you never want to come in and say that's the reason that we lost. And yes, there was calls like the horse collar earlier in the game that were bad calls, but to allow them to take the ball for the last 7.5 minutes and have those two third and forevers converted, one with an obvious no call and one with a terrible call. I'm sorry, but you know, they absolutely affected the outcome of the game. That horse collar call, it's a bad call. It happens earlier in the game. We didn't even get a chance to get the ball back. I just thought overall it was a piss poor job. And my biggest issue with that flag being thrown on Sauce was he stopped and wait. Is, I know that there's no, you know, statute of limitations, I guess, on when they could throw the flag, but it seemed like he waited way too long and saw the outcome and then decided to throw the flag. And I understand Sauce being upset about that. Quite frankly, when flags usually happen, the guy who's the more big time player usually gets the benefit of the doubt. Sauce is much more big time than MVS, and somehow he draws that call. I just thought that was a shit call. I thought that entire, and I saw a lot of people that were, you know, on Twitter, that were on the internet, that were talking about the fact that, you know, the game was right there in the balance for the Jets, and they would have liked to seen Zach get a chance to come out, and that they thought that those calls, and that's not just me. I know I have a very biased opinion. I just thought it was a shit job, and they robbed us all, but especially they robbed the Jets and their fans.
Yeah, no, nobody could watch that game and feel differently. Everybody feels like it was shitty calls at the worst possible time. But, you know, again, this is why, you know, it's all humans, man. And, you know me, I'm not a proponent of electronic officiating on any level, although we do have replays. But, you know, humans make mistakes, and these guys clearly made some huge mistakes that night. And they're going to – I don't know, has anything come out yet? Have they made any statement to the Jets saying that we missed this call or maybe that call shouldn't have been made? I don't even know how much sense that makes, because that does nobody any good.
Yeah, no, does nobody any good. Just, you know, a shit way to end what could have been a really, really good finish. But overall, definitely some positives to take from the Jets. Number one is the quarterback. Now, I come out here last week and I kill Zach Wilson, and I have to, you know, say that in this past game, he was not only the best I've ever seen him, but if he can play like that, not only do we have a chance to win some games, but, you know, he's our quarterback of the future. He was 28 of 39, 72% completion percentage, 2 touchdowns, 0 interceptions. Shout out to Jets 24/7, by the way. Love what they do over there. They put up these, you know, every throw or every snaps of the guys who aren't quarterbacks. And it's a really good way to just, you know, digest all of this different information that you can see from going back and watching the game. But, you know, Zach looked great. He did what one thing that I've been begging him to do, which is throw up a 50-50 ball early to Lazard, and Lazard rewarded him by going and getting it. I thought that was huge for his confidence. And then after that, you know, just beautiful back shoulder throws to, you know, Conklin and Ruckert, you know, for first downs. And then, you know, the touchdown throws were both great throws. I mean, just exactly where they needed to be. The throw to Lazard is maybe the best throw I've ever seen him make. And, you know, a throw that not a lot of guys in the NFL can make. He threw that ball to the only place it could be, small window, and just zinged it in there. He seems to be playing with a ton of confidence. We'll dive into Hackett a little bit more, but definitely he did a much better job as well. What do you think about Zach, his performance, and what it says for the Jets and the rest of the season?
You know, I've always been pro-Zach, and pro-Zach, that's funny. But then last week, I was starting to slip into the abyss where I was like, maybe this guy doesn't have it, you know? And listen, the guy does concern you. He's not out of the woods yet. It's not over. But I always felt, and I always preached, that Zach has serious quarterback skills. He has real ability with his mostly with his arm, and he can move his feet pretty well. He just has to be in the proper game plan and in the proper movement and the proper frame of mind. And it seemed like a lot of those things came together last week, and it made a huge difference there. You know, these guys, I mean, the guy needs to play like that often, and the team needs to rally around him, and they need to coach him properly. But the guy has the ability. You know, there's been certain guys in the past that I think just didn't have the requisite ability to make certain throws or do this or that. I think Zach has one of the better arms we've seen on the Jets in quite a while. And if he can continue to play smart and play like he did, I think we, you know, we might have something there.
Yeah, I mean, listen, no one's ever questioned Zach's arm strength. The thing that, you know, that we saw out of him against the Chiefs was the fact that he was just getting the ball out quick. He was extremely decisive. He was, you know, making the right reads. It seemed like he was making a lot more pre-snap changes than he typically does, which definitely, you know, speaks to his command of the offense overall. So, yeah, listen, hope that we continue to see Zach improve. I'm hoping that this isn't one of those like mirages that, like, you know, Geno Smith would give us every once in a while. Geno was good for every once in a while, sprinkling in a game where you were like, okay, this is the guy. And then, you know, would fall off thereafter. So I'm just hoping that, you know, we can continue to support him, make the catches for him. There was even still that Michael Carter catch in the third down at the end of the first half. That would have been huge if he'd have made that catch. And then also that touchdown that Conklin dropped early earlier in the game, where it was a low throw. Zach's running. He's going across his body. He slings it in there. It hits you in the hand. You're a tight end. I need you to make that catch. So definitely hope that, you know, Zach is, I hope that it's just a microcosm of things that we can see from him in the future to come. And I hope that's the case. I wouldn't say I'm 100% confident that it's the case, but, you know, he gives you reason to be optimistic. He gives you reason to believe with his performance in that game. And he's clearly grown up since last season. And you can see that in his post-game comments. The fact that, you know, he handled that the way that he did, I thought definitely shows maturity from last year. And, you know, it wasn't fake, because you could see him during the game that he was really crestfallen about the fact that, you know, he had made that fumble. Getting to the fumble, he did have a key fumble in the second half that ended up being the last time that we touched the ball. So in the fourth quarter, halfway through, fumbles the ball on a snap. Snap wasn't the best snap in the world, somewhat low, but at the end of the day, he's got to handle that, and that's a huge mistake. He owned up to it. You know, I feel like I would be killing the guy for it, but with the rest of the way that he played throughout the game, you know, I'm not even making a big deal with that. Hopefully, you know, Zach can build on that and show us that he really is that dude in these next few weeks.
Yeah, you know, when that fumble happened, I was very upset, obviously, but I just always figured we were getting the ball back. There was over 7 minutes left. I figured we're going to get the ball back. You know, can we just hold them to a field goal? That was the whole thing, you know, and yeah, it just snowballed from there, and we never saw the ball again. So that was pretty upsetting. But, you know, listen, go Zach. I hope he can figure this out. I hope, you know, he can figure this out. And listen, I look at, like, Geno. Geno is a good ball player now. Zach is clearly one of those guys that need some time. He needed some time when he first came in. He should have never been a starter when he first came in the league. He should have had a year or two to sit. They should have had some veteran guy there playing in front of him, and that would have made the difference. That was a huge mistake on the coaching staff. And like I said a week or two ago, you know, clearly the combination of rookie head coach, rookie quarterback, and rookie offensive coordinator is not a good combo. But I think Zach, I honestly think Zach, whether it's with the Jets or not, I think Zach's going to be a quarterback in this league. I really do. I think it'll just, you know, if it's not happening now, I hope it happens. But if the Jets end up getting fed up with him after this year and getting rid of him, I think he'll end up sticking around in the league, and somehow he will reemerge, whether it be now or in a couple of years.
Time will tell.
That's just
we'll see. Yeah. No, yeah. We'll see. We'll see. Got to give Hackett some love. You know, I've killed this guy so far, but that was by far the best game that Hackett has called. I thought that he mixed it up. I thought that he opened things up with the play action. He let Zach throw on first down, which everybody had been screaming about. We saw some more Gibson getting involved, and it just It didn't seem like going into every play, I knew exactly what we were going to do. And it didn't seem like the Chiefs knew what
Right.
we were going to do either. So that to me is the most important thing. I know the mix of run and pass is always going to be something that is kind of dictated by the game and something that, I can't even say I know best because Zach threw the ball 39 times and it was the best he's looked. And I've always felt like, hey, he needs to throw the ball less. So, hey, Hackett, you know more than me. Keep proving me that you know more than me. Feed Garrett. We got him 14 targets, 9 catches. Even though he wasn't able to break that big one, I thought that was super important. He still had some fantastic catches. That catch on the sideline, where if the ball bobbles just a little tiny bit, it's an incompletion, and it just like sticks to his hands. I mean, he's just an otherworldly ta talent. The one thing that I would like to see is just feed Breece. I did see today that Saleh said that we are not going to have any sort of pitch count on Breece. That we are totally. He's full go. I'm glad to see that. I want to see him. I definitely want to see him getting more carries, and getting not just the majority, but the lion's share because, Dalvin Cooked. I think you said to me, you don't think you've seen him break a tackle all year. I mean, he just looks like he's totally done. I don't know if he's working himself back in, but if he's gonna work himself back in, he can do that during the week. During the game, I need more Michael Carter. Maybe go ahead and activate this guy Abanaconda. But Dalvin Cook, this guy, he looks like he's done.
He gets tackled by blades of grass. It's really bad. It's really bad sometimes. The guy just bums me out, man. I'm getting Le'Veon Bell vibes with this guy. And it's like all of a sudden the guy's spent. And it's like, what happened? What did I miss here? I mean, at the last end of last year, he was, rambling all over the field. This year, I would like to say he's 3 yards in a cloud of dust, but it's just the dust, no yards. It's very distressing. I just, I maybe that guy just needs more work and so forth, but we haven't got time for that. Not when you got Bree standing there. Sorry, guy. We're not going to spend our time trying to get you ready. We got to give Bree the ball. Got to feed Bree. Bree has to get the ball at least 15 times next game. At least. It was
Yeah.
six times this past game, right? Six
Yeah,
almost.
six touches. He's got to get more touches. They got to figure that out. I mean, and the thing is that even in those small amount of touches, he gets that one sweep and busts it up. And if he doesn't make one more cutback, or if Conklin's able to stay on his feet, and could just be able to chip that guy, he's pay dirt. So I definitely want to see Breece get some more touches. I'd like to see him get some more designed, like maybe some wheel things. But hey, the offense looked competent. They looked like an NFL offense and they played pretty well. So I'm not going to sit here and have a ton of, different criticisms. I do want to see Breece get the ball more, but more of the same. Let's get Zach throwing the ball down the field, showing off that strong arm, and let's figure out a way to move the ball and score some points against Denver. Moving
Oh,
on
yeah.
to get a little bit more specific about the offense. The offensive line, I thought, had their best game of the season. And I
No doubt.
thought that something that we talked about a lot in the preseason, but actually seems to be happening now, is we have our best five out there. We talked about the best five. Saleh kept saying that over and over in the preseason. We made a huge mistake by trotting out the corpse of Dwayne Brown to try and play left tackle, the second most important position in the NFL, and that cost us. It cost us in those first few games. And now that we have these guys in, they're getting some time under. I think they're just going to continue to get better. Obviously, hopefully, everybody stays healthy. Elijah Barrett Tucker, I don't really see how even moving forward you move this guy back to guard. He's the
Right.
tackle, and a tackle is much harder to find in the NFL. The last 2 weeks, he's number two in the entire NFL, according to PFF. So I think that we gotta continue to just, he's our right tackle for the foreseeable future, hopefully for the next 10 years. Don't move him back to guard.
Hopefully.
I know they say that he's got the short arms, but he obviously knows how to get it done. And then also, Tippmann looked good. Tippmann looked much better than he did in the first game. I
Yeah,
thought,
very good.
he was mauling some guys. He gets to the second level very well. He's very agile for a guy that size. I mean, what do you think of the O-line and their performance on Sunday night?
Gotta love the O-line. I mean, like you say, AVT and Tippmann on that right side look great. Listen, you know what? Laken Tomlinson was great. He played very well because you didn't hear his name. So, you know, he played well. That's the sign of a good offensive line, a good offensive line play. And our man Becton, you know, he's got the toughest job on the line, but he's playing competent, and I think he's really coming into shape. And I think if we keep running the ball, you're going to see these guys get better and better. But they got some strength up there. And you know this guy Becton, he's an absolute mauler. So, you know, I think they played really well. You know, and again, the schemes were good for them. The schemes, you know, had them in the right position at the right time, sometimes moving the pocket. You know, there's just different things that Hackett did this past weekend that was very productive and showed some ingenuity. I feel like they took the reins off a little bit and they were just like throwing caution to the wind and let's go, let's get out there, let's play football and, you know, see what happens. And, you know, they weren't trying to just coddle Zach quite as much. And I think you're going to see more and more of that as the weeks go by. And I think this offensive line is just going to get stronger and stronger. You know, if we can win a couple games in here that we need to win, the second half of the season is a lot easier schedule-wise. You know, who knows? Maybe we might be able to do something. Might be able to make a little noise.
Yeah. No, I mean, listen, this next game is a must win, you know, just must as far win. As the season overall is concerned. And we'll get into what we think we're going to see next week. Talk to me about the defense. What did you think of the defense's performance? You know, obviously we got down 17-0 early, but then we're able to, you know, basically, you know, hold them to two field goals for the rest of the game. What do you think of the defense overall?
Hold them to 6 points in the second half. I mean, come on, you're talking about, you know, the Kansas City Chiefs here holding
3 points in the second half.
Oh, only 3 points in the second half. My bad. And holding Kelce to what, six catches or for like 60 yards? Nothing big. They really bottled him up, did a good job there. Because, you know, if we didn't play good enough defense, that guy would have exploded, and he didn't. I thought the defense played well. I mean, listen, you don't want to get down 17-0 or 17 points, you know, obviously. But that said, the defense played well enough to win, you know, and we should have gotten the ball back there at the end. Mind you now, listen, there are a couple of plays at the end there that, hey, I would have liked to have been able to stop them. That you know, but that's easier said than done. I mean, look, man, a lot of teams try to stop this Kansas City offense and don't even come close. We at least put up a hell of a fight and did a good job against them and put ourselves in a position to have a chance while they steamroll a lot of other people. So I thought the defense played well. I think we'll continue to play well. I thought the defense played well when Zach started playing better, believe it or not, because they seem to be more pumped. You know, look, man, when they see their offense out there actually doing things, that's got to get a defense excited and, you know, wanting, just in human nature, wanting to do more. And I think that was apparent out there. And I liked what I saw with the defense. You know, I mean, your man Mosley dropped one pick, which was a little distressing, which could have been a pick six, but then he made another pick, right? Mm-hmm. So then, you know, and then we had guys flying around the field. I love that. Quincy Williams is just fantastic. I mean, is this guy going to be, I mean, could he ever be like take over Mosley's position in a year or two? I mean, I don't know, because this guy, wow, man, he's all over the field. He's doing like things in coverage that I hadn't seen in years past. He brings the wood every time. You know, I love what I see from him. And the defensive line is still doing their thing. You know, I'd like to see a little more noise out of some of those guys. You know, Carl Lawson being the main one. But, you know, I think they're still playing well. And listen, your man, McDonald's, now he's pretty good. He can rush the passer. He's very fast. He's like a Bryce Huff type. But I will tell you, Nick, I saw a couple plays where he was in there. When they're running the ball, this guy should not be in the game. This guy's not great against the run. Not yet. He's young. He'll get there. But right now, that's not his forte at all.
Yeah, so as far as the defense is concerned, at the end of the day, you give up, you know, 23 points to the Chiefs. You feel like you're doing a good job overall. We got to figure out a way to start the game faster. It seems that we always play better in the second half. And I think that one of the reasons, beyond just the fact that seeing Zach play well, you know, makes you feel better, I think that when Zach starts to play well, then they have more time to make adjustments. It seems like our team is good. They do a good job of making adjustments at halftime. In the first half, when we're getting nothing but three and outs or the entire game, as some of these last couple have been, the defense never really has a chance to really make any adjustments. So if at the beginning of the game, I think we could sustain some more drives, I think the defense would be able to put the clamps on a little bit earlier, and maybe that game doesn't get that, you know, doesn't get away from us as much as it did early on in that first quarter. We got to figure out a way also to stop the run a little bit better. We don't have those big run stopper guys in the middle, at least not that play a lot of snaps. Even Quinnen, as good as he is, he's not a big defensive tackle. And we're getting crushed on the run. Teams are averaging 160 yards per game against us over the last 3 weeks. Definitely way too much, especially in today's NFL. We got to figure a way to tighten that up a little bit. Everything you said about Quincy is definitely true. This guy, I mean, all over the field, 13 tackles, two tackles for loss, two passes defended, just absolutely, as you said, I think you said that he brings the wood. I think it's lays the wood, pause. But yeah, oh. He's he every time he gets a chance to get a hit, he makes sure that he gets his money's worth. And one of the best celebrations in the game as well. Defense looks good. Would like to see us start faster. And the big thing for me is, even though there was that shit penalty that, you know, against Sauce, and there was the penalty that wasn't called, we got to figure out a way to get off the field at 30, 20, third and 20 plus.
Yeah.
You just got to figure out a way to do it. And once again, when it comes to the adjustments, even when it comes down to that very last play where he slid, on third down, he's killing us by running every time. How many times does it have to happen before we make an adjustment? Now, I understand that spying him means that somebody's going to be open. So they're right. Make an adjustment. Don't let this guy do the same thing to you over and over and over again. And we don't have a counter to it. I thought that was something that, you know, we definitely have to be able to not let this guy, like I said, do the same thing over and over again. But overall, we have a very good defense. The defense needs to, there's still another level. I could still see that there's another level that they can get to, and hopefully they get to that soon. But, you know, it's not a coincidence that Josh Allen and Mahomes have both had their worst games when playing against the Jets. I saw Stephen A. today talk about how he thought that Josh Allen was the MVP of the league, and he started off his statement talking about, well, let's just go ahead and forget about what happened in week one. And it's like, that's a quarter of the season. I mean, what do you mean forget about that? Like, no, we can't forget about that. He had a terrible game, and a terrible game against our defense, and Mahomes had a terrible game against our defense. So I think that definitely says something for, you know, what we can do as a unit. Just hoping that we can start faster and, you know, get it to even another level, you know, next week in Denver.
No doubt. I think we can. And yeah, I don't buy that. I mean, just give him a pass for week one. Okay. Yeah. Just give us a pass then for week two. No, it counts. You know, so I don't understand what he's talking about. But yeah, the defense played well. I mean, you know, we played well, relatively well. So like you said, I think there are other levels we can reach. I think we will reach. I think this team, you know, we have to win some of these games right in the middle here, because I really feel like this team is going to be on the upswing in the second half of the season. And, you know, listen, everything that happened in that first game with Aaron Rodgers really threw everything into a tailspin for a moment. And we're just, it seems, getting our feet again and really getting it together. And I think that'll make a difference going forward. I think we're in for some good stuff in the next few weeks, hopefully.
You bring up Aaron Rodgers. What do you think of, you know, him kind of swooping in and the overall, you know, effect that had on the team? And I must say, he was looking pretty spry.
Yeah, I don't think he'll be back this year, so we can kill that noise. But I think it was great that he's back. I mean, look, man, the guy's done everything right. The guy's still showing dedication to the team and to the organization. The guy clearly wants to be here, wants to be involved with the team, and you have to love that. I don't think there's any doubt that he probably had a very positive effect on Zach by him being there. That probably bolstered Zach's confidence. He probably spoke to Zach and, you know, come on, man. This guy is your number one booster, basically, besides Saleh. And, you know, he's whispering, you know, good things in your ear and probably giving you some good advice and telling you, hey, man, go out there and do it. You could do it. That's got to make any young guy feel good, you know. And I think it's obvious that it did have that effect on Zach. And, you know, just having him there. And then, you know, like everybody says, in a few weeks when he's a little after the bye, maybe, you know, up in the booth with the headset on now. I don't know that he's going to be calling plays, but he could maybe be talking to Zach between plays or between series, you know, just a lot of good stuff. Because realize now, in this past game, as well as Zach played, he wasn't talking to Zach throughout the game. You know, he spoke to him before and after the game. So, and I think, they said when the team didn't know he was coming in Saturday night when he came into, like, the team meeting at the hotel. So when he came in, the team had to be pumped, man. I mean, come on, man. And, he probably made a speech to the team. I did read, though, where he was a little, not annoyed, but he said, some of the things he said there in that meeting, something came out, and he said, we have to be better as a team. That sort of stuff should never come out. And he's right. So I don't know how that stuff got out or who mentioned it, but, that person has to be found and drawn and quartered or something.
Listen, I definitely think that they got a bump from him showing up and, just his presence overall. And I think that there's probably an X's and O's impact that he can have as well. I don't know how much he did on this particular game, but he's another football mind, one of the greatest ever, so I don't understand why you wouldn't want to have him around as much as possible. And definitely Zach played as confident as I've ever seen. So if Aaron Rodgers being there and being behind him has something to do with that, then obviously I want him to stay with the Jets. And I don't know if he's going to be traveling with us. Like, I don't know exactly how that's all going to work moving forward. We'll see how it plays out. It seems like, though, he's going to do as much as he can to help as much as he can and be around as much as he can. So definitely appreciate that. As far as Saleh is concerned, I love the fact that Saleh, lost his shit on that referee at the end. I love the fact that, he stood up for his guys in both his post-game press conference after that game and the conference on Monday. In both of those, it looked like steam was coming out of his ears. He was so angry, and I appreciate that. And I think the guys probably appreciate that as well.
I saw where one guy said, one guy at WFAN was saying how he thought he should have, after the game, should have gone off on the refs more at the podium. I have to say, in watching that post-game press conference, he was almost in tears. Had he let himself get emotional right there, he would have cried right there. He had to keep himself under control. And I get that, man. It's no time to be getting all blubbery over there. But I think he did the right thing in controlling it. On the sideline, he went full Xerxes on the sideline. He was losing his mind. The guy looks exactly like Xerxes. I mean, come on. But, yeah, he went nuts about that, and he should have. And, look, man, I'm a Saleh guy. I think Saleh's a good coach. I think clearly this team, how many people are saying, Saleh's going to lose the team or this, that, and the other thing with everything going on with Zach. Clearly this team is behind him, follows his lead, and he's a good coach, I think. I really do believe he's a good coach and a good leader of men. And I think that's one of the main things you have to be a good football coach in the NFL. He just does it differently than most guys have. He's not from the Bill Parcells or Rex Ryan school, but one of his main boosters is frankly Rex Ryan. I've seen Rex Ryan say many times how Saleh's the guy. I'm telling you, that's the coach. He is the guy, but I've also seen Rex say, hey, if they want me, just give me this amount of money and I'm there. So, Rex would love to be back,
Yeah, no, I again, Saleh, I thought they handled everything really well. I thought that as a team, just this past week, there was a lot of times that he could have made a misstep, and he seemed to navigate it really well with Zach's performance against New England and, everything that came with that. I thought that he's handled everything really well, but, it's a week-to-week league, so we'll see what happens this week. This week, we travel to Denver to play against the Broncos. Broncos had a big comeback win last week against Chicago. They are now sitting at 1-3, as are we. Everybody knows about the comments that Peyton made in the offseason regarding Nathaniel Hackett and regarding the Jets in general. What are you expecting to see? How are you feeling about this game this Sunday at 4:25 Eastern?
I think that the Jets are going to smash the Broncos. At least I hope they do. No, and I actually think they're going to win. I think the Broncos were lucky to get out of that game with Chicago with a win, and that was because the Chicago coach is a bit of an idiot, and not kicking the field goal when he had the chance. I don't even understand what you're thinking with that. I think you kick the field goal, you take the lead in a tight game like that. But instead, you know, went for it for whatever reason. I think that our defense will do well against them, and I think their defense is pretty weak. And that's what I was saying to you last week. It would be a shame if Zach got benched against KC, and then you let some new guy come in against Denver, and he shines, you know, like Simeon or somebody. I'm glad that Zach is going to get the opportunity to play against this team. I still think they need to run the ball. But if they can run the ball well enough, which I think they can against this team, Zach's passing game is going to be even better because it's play action. I think he was like 9 of 12 off of play action. You know, I mean, a really good, you know, percentage off of play action. So I think if you put him in that position where you're running the ball well, Zach will really shine. I'm feeling good about this game. I feel positive. Of course, I'm nervous because we absolutely have to have this game. I mean, we have to have this game. We have this game. We win this game. That puts us in really good position going forward. Who knows against Philly? Listen, like if we beat Denver, then we're going to be going into Philly saying, hey, you never know. You never know. And then after the bye, we got the Giants. I think we should win that game. So I think this could put us on a good roll going forward.
Yeah. I mean, listen. Right now, if you look at Jets Broncos, we're 2.5-point dogs. I think if we don't win that game by 10, I'll be surprised and, you know, somewhat alarmed, just because I think that Denver is terrible. I think that we have all the reason to be up for this game. We should be confident coming in off of last week's performance. We should also want to go out and win this game for Coach Hackett and the way that he was talked about. Everybody said that was totally Bush League, what this guy Sean Payton did. You know, said it was one of the worst coaching performances in the history of the NFL. So we need to come out and we need to make this guy eat his words, and we need to bust the ass. And I hope that from the very beginning, their defense is absolutely dominant. And the fact that, you know, they've been giving up a lot of rushing yards here recently, as you said, we should be able to run the ball. I expect a big game out of Breece, and then soften him up and go over the top to my man Garrett Wilson. Definitely looking for a big game. And if this game is close at the end and we still figure out a way to win, hey, a win is a win. If we somehow lose this game, the season's over. We got no chance to make the playoffs, because if they can't sack up and get it done this week, then the identity of this team, the coaching staff, you know, the players, I'll start to question everybody.
Everything comes into question if we don't get it done this week. I am a little concerned with Russell Wilson and his ability to move his feet and run around a little bit. So that's a bit of a concern. But then again, he's also prone to making some big mistakes too. So, you know, listen, man, all our defensive players, the defensive backs and the linebackers, got to be on the jugs machine this week, because they're going to get some chances to catch some balls. So they need to catch them when they come their way.
Welcome back to the show. We can thank Mrs. Goodrich for setting off the fire alarm mid-show, but we can go ahead and we can pivot to the New York Metropolitans. Buck Showalter stepped down on Sunday. Doesn't seem like he actually stepped down. Seems like he was fired and was just given the option to handle it that way. What do you think of your man Buck being shown his walking papers?
Yeah, I was a little disappointed. I mean, I like Buck. I was a little sad to see him go. But, you know, it's a results business. And as Cohen says, you know, you can't bring in a guy and then expect him, you know, guys, this guy Stearns comes in and he's going to want to have his own guy. So that's the way the game is. And that's the way people manage the game and so forth. But I think Buck is a very good baseball mind. I would love it if somehow they could keep him in the organization, but they won't be able to, obviously. I think Buck still wants to manage, and I think he will get hired. So, you know, I mean, it's tough, man. You know, you can be manager of the year 1 year, and the next year you're out. We're seeing that right now across town in football, actually. But, you know, you just see that, and it's a shame, but it's reality. I'm not going to yell and scream about it. But I like Buck, and I think the team liked Buck. But, you know, maybe you need a more fiery guy. Maybe you need a guy to light a fire under these guys some more. Because, I mean, listen, you can't deny what happened this year as well as what happened at the tail end of last year. So, you know, hey, if the next guy does better, I hate to say it, but, you know, ain't nobody going to be crying for Buck, least of all me. So we move on. You know, what can you do?
Listen, hopefully we can catch some of that post-Buck magic, both with the Diamondbacks and with the Yankees. They, you know, won World Series right after he, you know, was shown the outs. But, yeah, I mean, honestly, listen, I like Buck. It seems like the guys like Buck. They say that Pete Alonso was so upset he had to be restrained from going and talking to Uncle Stevie personally. So, yeah, I don't know. You know, what Stern sees or, you know, what people are seeing that make them feel like they need to move on. But one of the things is when you bring in a new guy, as you said, you got to trust in him and you got to trust that he's going to make the right decisions. So, you know, right. Buck is out. And with the end of last season being what it was and this season going the way that it did, you can't sit here and, you know, throw your hands up and say that, you know, he was unjustly fired. He's out. Sorry, Buck. But hopefully the next guy that we bring in, I'm hearing some Craig Council talk, but, you know, we'll see about the next guy that we bring in. It'll probably be somebody who's a lot younger, somebody who pays a little bit more attention to the analytics. I didn't always love the way that Buck handled the pen. So hopefully we can get a guy in who can take what Buck is laid as far as a foundation and take these guys along with some new talent and some free agents that are injected in, and we can have a more successful season next year. With Stearns and his introductory press conference, only so much you could take from a press conference. But one thing that I do really like is the fact that this guy is a lifelong Mets fan. He talked about wanting to have his kids grow up as Mets fans. They're at the ages now where they're going to really start paying attention. So he thinks that's cool. And just overall, I mean, same thing with Uncle Stevie. I like having a guy who, when he's making decisions, he's making them from a smart baseball mind, but also from the mind of a fan and understanding what we feel as well. So hopefully, I know a lot of people. One of my buddies who is a Red Sox fan, when they had an opening, he was screaming, "Let's go get this guy Stearns." So I know that a lot of people, you know, really respect this guy in the baseball world. I'm glad that he's ours. Seems like him and Uncle Stevie have a very symbiotic, you know, strong relationship that they're building. And, you know, hopefully this can be the guy who leads us to years of sustained greatness, or just at least, you know, a team that is always in the hunt and, you know, has a farm system that has the ability to not only go out there and be able to trade and get guys, but have some guys waiting in the wings when, you know, some of the older veterans falter.
Yeah, no, I feel like our farm system is definitely picking up. This guy Stearns is obviously a bright guy, a Harvard guy. So, you know, he's a smart guy. And also too, I heard some people saying, oh, he never even spoke to Buck before he fired him. But the fact of the matter is he was under contract up to like a day before or something. So he couldn't legally speak to Buck and tell him, hey, Buck, you're out. You know, so that's how that went down. And he did say he was going to make sure he made it a point to speak to Buck now, you know, like afterwards, once he wasn't under contract anymore. So, you know, we got to give the guy a chance, see what he can do. They said they're going to keep Epler around as GM. I don't really know how that works exactly. I mean, you know, Epler's going to be there, but anything he does, Stearns has to co-sign, right? I mean, obviously, he's Epler's boss now. So he's everybody's boss now on the Mets. So, you know, listen, I trust in Stevie. I trust in Stevie, and let's see what this guy does for us and whatnot. The real reason I don't like getting rid of Buck is just because, you know me, I don't like a lot of turnover. So I'm hoping the next manager we get is here for like 5 years at least. I just think that consistent turnover with your teams and your pro teams, you're just constantly, you know, spinning your wheels. And I don't like to see that. But I think, you know, you got to make some moves and make some changes. And hopefully this is the last management change we'll make for a while.
Yeah, no, you don't want to get known as that organization that's got a new manager every couple of years. So yeah, would definitely like to see some continuity there in the managerial spot, but, you know, we'll see as far as, who the next guy they bring in is, and we'll be sure to tackle that when it happens. Let's go ahead and switch over to the Knicks. Get real excited for Knicks season. Monday was media day. We got, training camp has began. It's down in Charleston, South Carolina at the Citadel. I'm actually reading the book right now, Blood in the Garden by Chris Herring. And that book starts off with that first training camp that took place down there. Really hot gym. I'm guessing that the facilities are probably a little bit better now than they were, than the ones that they describe in that game. And there's probably not quite as many, you know, punches being thrown in practices. But just taking a look at Media Day, I'm getting hyped. You know, we got the Villanova four. What are you thinking? How are you feeling with training camp getting started for the Knicks?
Well, listen, I'm pumped, obviously. I can't wait for the season to start. Looking forward to, you know, them doing their thing and making it happen. I think it's going to be a good team. I think we've got a good core of players. I think the togetherness, and to use your word that you just used, the continuity is going to make a big difference going forward. I think Dante DiVincenzo is going to be a good add. Like I told you, I really think Grimes is going to ramp up this year, and I hope RJ does the same. We need that. I didn't know if you noticed, but I hope you do notice that your man Randall, has really taken a page out of Bruce Lee, and he got a Bruce Lee tattoo as well. He's big Bruce Lee now. You know, he's like, be like water, that whole thing. So, you know, he says he's trying to, you know, use more meditation and just be more flexible and so forth, both in mind and body. So, you know, and just deal with things a little bit better and his emotions better. So I think that bodes well. I hope that carries into the season and we see a lot more of that. I think Brunson's a stud, you know, and I think we have some good players. I do still feel like we could use a little more shooting, but hopefully this guy DiVincenzo gives us that when he gets in the game, you know, because we do need some more shooting. We absolutely need this guy Grimes to really take his game up a few notches because we need his shooting and we need his game, both outside shooting and going to the hole. I think he can do both. He just needs more confidence. And I think, you know, from what I read with his training this summer, he's got some more confidence. And same with your man Quick. You know, Quick's got to come in there just looking to just eat some people up. You know, he's got to be chomping after the showing in last year's postseason. So I think we're going to see a lot of good things from the Knicks this year. I'm hoping for at least a 50-win season.
Oh, yeah, definitely getting 50 wins. Listen, man, my man Randall, he got the season. He got, you know, he got rid of the crazy hair. He's looking a little extra swole. You know he's been working. My man Randall's ready. You got your man Jalen Brunson. I mean, he's going to be first team All NBA this year. I'm calling that right now. He's going to be undeniable. He got hosed last year not being an all-star. This year, he's going to get his flowers. We're going to see him in year two continue to blossom for the Knicks. RJ got the little, you know, he got the tight edge up. You know, RJ got a questionable edge up every once in a while. He got the tight edge up with a little bit of hair on top to balance off that, you know, that pea head he's got for such a large human. And so he's ready to go. I think, that's why he's got needs a little bit on top. So he balances out. He doesn't look so beetle juicy. But your man, Grimes, I think Grimes is ready to level up. He spent time with Penny Hardaway this offseason. He spent time with JJ Redick this offseason. Yes. He's going to be doing work coming off the screen. I think the JJ Redick time, and I saw some of the comments that JJ Redick made about him, that got me really excited as well.
Absolutely.
My man, quickly, he's playing for a contract. He looked a little bit strong when I saw him. He said he worked on his strength a little bit. I think that he's going to level up. Listen, the Knicks, I got the Knicks winning 55 games. I got the Knicks making it to the Eastern Conference Finals and making it to at least a game six against the Bucks. And, you know, listen, just like they say, shout to CP, the franchise, and everybody over at Knicks Fans TV. I'm jumping out the window. Well, I think we're about to, you know, we've been putting it in. We've been building slowly. And this is the year where we become a perennial contender in the Eastern Conference and in the entire NBA.
I agree. I think we can do that. And then, you know, what's going to happen, Nick? Like I always say, what happens then is we become more of an appealing destination for some free agent. It's not going to be Giannis, it doesn't look like, after this year, but some free agent that we could really use where we don't have to give up any of these key pieces. You know, I don't want to trade where we're giving up half the team, and now we got some player, Brunson, and that's it, you know, and a bunch of also-rans. No, that's not a recipe for winning. I'm glad we stood pat this off-season, and I think it's going to bode well for us going forward. I really am excited for this year. You know, I think Tibbs will do a good job again, and we just have to – we have to play smart. We have to play strong. But I think we'll do those things. And I do think there's a serious togetherness with this team. I feel like they really care for one another. They actually do care for one another and care about the game and the team. So, you know, I think that is going to do well for us during the season.
Yeah, and I love the idea of getting out of the city, going down to South Carolina, you know, and kind of just, you know, get into our own foxhole and really bonding as a team. Like you said, we have a lot of guys who have been together now for a few years. We have the Villanova Four. Those guys have, you know, obviously go way back. And I think that there is a togetherness, like you said, with this team that sets us apart from a lot of the other teams in the NBA. And I think that if you look at a team like Denver, that was one of the strengths that they had last year, was that they, you know, had fought together many years, you know, prior, and they were just finally to the point where they got enough health and guys were ready. They added a couple key pieces and they were able to get over the hump. I think my man Julius is going to be top five in the MVP voting this year. I think he's going to have a huge year. I think that, you know, the Bruce Lee shit, obviously, I love. I'm a big Bruce Lee guy. I got the Tao of Jeet Kune Do right here, the Tao of Jeet Kune Do right here next to me. And yeah, so I think that him just, you know, taking in that both, you know, mental and that all just overall fortitude and being calm under pressure, I think that him continuing to seek out different inspirations and different ways to master that shows that, you know, he's a guy who's continually trying to grow. And if there's one thing that we've seen from Julius Randle, you don't win most improved player by not being a guy who's willing to put in the work. So hopefully that mental side can catch up to what we've seen as far as his game taking leaps these last few years. I did read an article by, it was in Complex. It was by Zion Olojide. Sorry if I'm butchering your last name, brother, but he talked about the best duos in the NBA right now. He ranked the top 12. Julius and Brunson were honorable mentions, didn't make the top 12. I'm sorry, but I got beef with this list. Okay, there's a few people on there. You know, Tatum and Jaylen Brown, I can see you arguing them, but I think Tatum's one of the five best players in the league. I think Jaylen Brown is really good, but then other times totally doesn't show up. So, hey, all right, you can say the same thing about Julius in these last couple of years. I get that one. AD and LeBron, no. Not AD. That guy wakes up, you know, with some sort of pull or strain every single day. Most important ability is availability. LeBron's getting up in age. I do not think that they are a better duo. I think that you have to take in their ability to be on the floor has to be something that you take in. Kawhi and Paul George, same reason. Those guys are never on the floor. Too much injury.
Kyrie never together.
Never together. Kyrie and Luka. I mean, Kyrie and Luka, I think that they're both great individual talents as far as a duo. Once again, you know, Kyrie, his availability gets affected by a whole bunch of different things, not just injury. But, you know, I need to see them do something together or at least play a season together before I start throwing them in. Ja and Jaren Jackson. No, not Ja and Jaren Jackson. Ja's a great talent. But obviously, he's got a whole host of reasons why, you know, you got to be nervous if this guy's the best guy on your team. He also gets dinged up quite a bit. Jaren Jackson is also always hurt and wasn't a great defender at the World Cup here just recently. But no, I don't put them in front of him. And De'Aaron Fox and your man Baby Bonus, Sabonis Jr. or whatever, Sabonis' son. They're not better than Julius and Brunson. And I hope that they saw this article. I hope they take it personally that the fact that they weren't even on this list. And by the end of this season, I think they're going to be consensus top five.
I will tell you somebody who I saw on that list who I didn't think is better than Julius. And, you know, I'm sure I'll get pushback on this from some people. But Donovan Mitchell and Darius Garland. Now, look, I think that kid Darius Garland is pretty good. But better than Julius and Jalen Brunson? I don't think so, man. I mean, Donovan, too. I mean, listen, Donovan Mitchell, he was unlocked in the playoffs last year, okay? We locked him up, okay? You know, so I don't think that's a better duo than Julius and Jalen Brunson right now. I honestly do not. So, yeah, I agree with you. I think they should be on that list, but I think at the end of this year, it's going to be undeniable.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yes.
What did you think about last week? I know that you picked the Dolphins to beat the Bills. Obviously, the Bills came out and they won big 48-20. What did you think of that game? And, you know, what do you think that says about the Dolphins and, you know, their rank in the hierarchy as far as best teams in the NFL?
Definite chink in the armor for the Dolphins. I mean, you know, come on, man. You got to do better than that. And the Bills kind of dominated them that game. Okay. So I don't even think the game was as close as the score, even though the score wasn't that close. What's his name? McDaniel, he's offensive genius, all this and that. But, you know, like you say, it's a week-to-week league. You can be great 1 week, not so great the next week. But it shows you that, you know, it's not just a track meet with these guys, the Dolphins. The Bills, you know, figured out how to slow these guys down somewhat. And, you know, it's a copycat league. Everybody's going to do it now. So let's see what the Dolphins can do now that the plan has been laid out there. You know, I was a little surprised that they couldn't put out a better showing against Buffalo. But you know what? Buffalo's starting to find their stride. They are playing a lot better, clearly playing better. I mean, look, they played worse against us, and clearly a large part of that is because of our defense. But they are playing better. There's no doubt about it. Josh Allen seems to be making less foolish mistakes. But still, the Dolphins were a little disappointing that game. So we'll see what they can do. And you know what? With all this track meet stuff, if they can't play any defense, it ain't going to matter. You know, they need to be able to stop people at times, too. Or else, you know, they're not going to win just running by people. That's just not the way the NFL works. Not long term.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, they figured out a way to slow them down. And now we're going to see whether or not, you know, McDaniels and the rest of that offense can counterpunch, because everybody in the league is going to be doing the same thing. I just thought that, you know, at the end of the day, it's another example of how good the Jets defense is, and the fact that they were able to, that the Bills have looked so good. And then, you know, that just got cemented even more that night when we came out and, you know, held Cincinnati to 23 points. But overall, I definitely think, you know, it takes the Bills and it puts them in the conversation for one of the best teams in the NFL. The Dolphins, now we're going to see them play against other teams with strong defenses, with offenses that can put up some points. And we're going to see if they have the ability to, you know, sustain some of this success, if that was just a blip in the radar, or if, you know, they just weren't as good as they showed playing against some inferior talent those first few weeks. Definitely looking forward to see, you know, what those teams do, and definitely looking forward to our next matchups against both of those teams. I think that we got something for the Dolphins. And I think that, you know, we've dominated Josh Allen at this point over the last couple seasons. And I think that we have definitely shown a chink in his armor, and we'll continue to do that. That pressure that we get on him up the middle, and that kind of that defense that we play, where we play a lot of zone, he doesn't typically end up, he doesn't have the patience to not throw some balls up, and we've been able to take advantage of him here recently. The Niners play the Cowboys this Sunday. Big matchup in the NFC. Niners, who I think are the best team in the NFL. It's Sunday Night Football. What do you think with that game, and what do you think are the implications of that game for the rest of the season?
I think the Niners are going to win that game because I think they're a better team. But I think Dallas is, it's going to be interesting. It's going to be a great game to watch. Both of those teams play extremely hard, and the defenses of both those teams are very tough, hard-hitting defenses. So we're going to see something. But, you know, Niners at the end of the day have so many weapons on offense that it's hard to control them. This guy McCaffrey is just out of control. He's probably the best back in the league right now. And then you still got Deebo Samuels, Ayuk, and Kittles, you know. So they've got a very dynamic offense. And Brock Purdy is playing smart. He plays smart. He places the ball well. And he just plays within himself, you know. So they have a fantastic game plan consistently. That said, I do think Mike McCarthy is doing a good job, especially with the offense, with the Cowboys. I do think he's doing a very good job. And, you know, Mike McCarthy knows how to run an offense, man. That's just a fact, you know. So I think that's going to be a very good game. Obviously, many eyeballs watching that game. I'll surely be tuned in, so will you. This is going to be exciting, but I do like the Niners. I like the Niners by maybe a touchdown.
Yeah, I like the Niners as well.
Where's the game?
The game is in Dallas, I'm pretty sure. But I like the Niners as well. I think that overall, they're just such a balanced team. As you said, oh no, I'm sorry. The game is in San Francisco. So oh, wow. They're the home team. And I just think overall they're such a balanced team. I mean, they have a fantastic defense. They have a great defensive line, which obviously we know other than a quarterback is probably the most important thing that you can have in the NFL. And then this guy Purdy, he's not just a game manager. He finds a way to spread the ball out. CMC, he's been the best running back in the NFL for years, and now he's in the perfect scheme. It's just about with him. It's always health. And I just hope that I'd like to see him just be able to stay healthy and have this entire full season and, really see what he can do and what kind of numbers. He's on pace for like 2,500 scrimmage yards right now. Just, can do it all. Crazy. I wouldn't be surprised if we see him throw a touchdown this week. He does it. He does everything. Definitely looking forward to that. It's a good Sunday night game. That, from my early years in the early 90s, like that was like the biggest rivalry in the NFL at the time. It was the Cowboys and the Niners. And, they were always matching up in the playoffs. And as Jerry Jones said here recently, the NFC goes through San Francisco. So we're going to see, a big early season matchup between those two. I think that there's a good chance that the Niners could win by 10 plus just because I think that the Cowboys, when they end up playing against a defense that is able to really limit the big plays and they're forced to, convert a lot of third downs as well as convert in the red zone, they typically don't do as well. And I think that Niners defense is probably the best in the league and is going to, force them to do the things that they don't like to do. So overall, I'm looking forward to the game and we'll see what happens this Sunday. But yeah, Niners still the best team in the NFL until anybody knocks them off, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's going to be an exciting matchup. I do like Dak Prescott, so I root for him. I want him to do well. But I'm not going to cry over anybody winning or losing that game. But there's a couple guys on both of those teams who I want to see do well, and I just want to see a very exciting game. That's the main thing.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for checking us out. You can catch us every Thursday on YouTube or wherever you find your podcasts. Please like and subscribe. And you can find us on all socials at he_did_this_to_me. Love you, big guy.
Love you, kid.